When it comes to motivation, we often try to motivate someone so that they'll be moved to action. But one of life's immutable principles is that motivation follows action, not the other way around. Motivating your people can be pretty tricky. Trying to work out what you can do to help your people reach a state of motivation and stay there for a little while is more complicated than it sounds. Should you try to make them happy? Should you pay them more? Should you lavish them with praise and positive feedback? The truth about what motivates people might surprise you. Now, interestingly, the path to motivation isn't an easy one, and it's not a path that many people will tread of their own accord. We've produced a couple of episodes in the last few years about how to approach the task of motivating your people. And obviously, what works for one person doesn't necessarily work for another. But there are some relatively simple things that you can do that have a high success rate. It's just that, like all the best leadership stuff, it's not easy. And it forces you to face the specter of not being liked. Now, that's enough to turn many leaders off the concept altogether. So I'm going to start with a quick look at how the landscape has changed in recent times. I'll then revisit some of the core concepts of motivation and how to tap into people's intrinsic motivational drivers. And I'll finish with some tips for how to nurse people through that tricky period between when action starts and when motivation kicks in. A lot has happened since I last looked at the topic of motivation. All the way back in 2019, I released two episodes in fairly quick succession. The first was a Q&A, episode 30, When Money Doesn't Motivate. And I followed this up a few weeks later with episode 36, If Money Doesn't Motivate, What Does? Now, since then, we've seen the move to much more flexible working arrangements. And this has brought with it an expectation that working from wherever you want, whenever you want, is a right, not a privilege. There's no doubt that a lot of stuff can be done productively from home, or from anywhere else for that matter. But as leaders, you've got to think a bit more broadly than just the question of task delivery. You have to consider team performance, culture, innovation, talent management. These don't lend themselves anywhere near as readily to having your people spread to the four winds. And we've also seen some labour market upheaval. Now, in many countries, there's been a swing back to left-leaning governments. And the clock's being wound back on industrial relations laws, often wiping out decades of progress. These laws can be incredibly restrictive when applying even the most basic leadership disciplines, like performance management. I have a number of clients who are frustrated beyond belief at the degree of difficulty in executing some relatively straightforward decisions in this environment. So whereas the strict laws might be good to protect individuals from unscrupulous employers, they also dumb down the workforce by making it more difficult to differentiate between individuals. And this is a prerequisite for both individual and team performance. Instead, we have a small but noticeable shift to the lowest common denominator. What else is going on? Well, look, without harping on it, there are the well-documented trends of the Great Resignation and quiet quitting, which are probably more notable for the mood that the media hype has managed to create in the people, rather than any structural shifts in the world of work. Now, people are trying to exercise their choice to work less, but they still want to be paid the same, if not more, than they were before. Which does go some way to explaining why we're starting to see productivity declines in many Western countries. As we look at the younger generations entering an aging workforce, they've never had to work in the manner or at the intensity that many of us would have had to in the past. Which is not to say that's necessarily a bad thing, but it seems entirely natural to them that they should have a four-day work week carried out from wherever they choose. Unfortunately, they're entering a workforce where, at the moment, the majority of other people are likely to be outworking them. And even though they may have been raised with participation trophies and ninth place medals, the reality is that these things are unlikely to pan out the way they think they will in the real world. All of this adds up to people being motivated by different criteria than perhaps they would have been in the past. And of course, they'll make decisions based on these drivers. So the first interesting thing to think about is that as humans, we're much better at working out what's in our best short-term interest than our best long-term interest. In episode 30, we answered a listener question about money as a motivator for people. To cut a long story short, money is generally a hygiene factor. It isn't the primary motivator. Your pay has to be good enough. It has to be fair. It has to be market competitive. And it has to meet the requirements of the psychological contract. You know, that's the unwritten contract that an employer and an employee have in their heads as a yardstick for what's fair to expect from each other. You can actually motivate people with bonuses if they're substantial enough. But interestingly, this is unlikely to drive improved performance. So if it doesn't improve outcomes, you're really only using bonuses as an employer retention strategy. Now, as we get back to the concept of individual differentiation, you want to pay your best people more. I found over the years that pay bands and compa ratios are entirely inadequate for this. And in most large organizations, that's all you've got to work with. You might be able to pay your top performers, say, 10 to 15% above the average for their role. But they're not delivering 10 to 15% more than the average person. They're delivering 100 to 150% more. And they will likely feel that they're not fairly compensated for the value they bring. Now, having said that money isn't a primary motivator, don't get me wrong, money is cool. It won't make you happy per se, but it's an enabler for making everything you do easier. And because humans are predominantly short-term thinkers, many people will make a decision based on money. Why would I work here when I can get 30% more over there? Fair enough too, I guess. The job market seems to be settling a little though, so this may not be quite so much of a factor going forward. Following up on my episode about why money isn't the primary motivator, episode 36 explored the question a bit further. What does motivate people? Daniel Pink published a definitive work on human motivation in his book, Drive: The Surprising Truth About What Motivates Us. Pink's conclusion, spoiler alert here, human motivation is driven by three things: autonomy, mastery, and purpose. Let's start with autonomy. People want to be able to influence their environment, to exercise their power of choice, and to not be constantly told what to do. If you can give people a sense of autonomy, this will motivate them much more than a 3% pay rise could. But this is one of the harder elements of motivation to achieve. It means you have to empower people to make decisions that are appropriate for their level and responsibilities. And the interesting thing is that empowerment and accountability have to travel together. You can't get this wrong. They're two sides of the same coin. If you give people the empowerment to make decisions and do things their way, then you have to also make them accountable for the outcomes they produce. Likewise, if you make people accountable for delivering outcomes, they have to be empowered and they have to have the autonomy to be captains of their destiny. The second motivating force is mastery. People like to feel that sense of accomplishment that comes with improving and becoming more capable in the things they do. A real sense of pride often coincides with the gaining of mastery, not to mention the increase in expert power that gives them more cachet in their organization's hierarchy. The third motivating force is purpose. Now, we produced an episode a few months ago, episode 201, Finding Your Purpose, which was one of my favorites from the whole of last year. In this episode, I drew a clear distinction between finding your life's purpose and finding a purpose in your life. So as a leader, the more you can bring a sense of purpose to your people's work, hey, the better. It doesn't necessarily have to align with their life's purpose, and let's face it, it probably won't. That's going to be different for everyone. But people need to feel that they're doing more than just cranking the handle and picking up a paycheck. Communicating a genuine, unambiguous purpose to rally your people around can be really challenging. Why should your people bother to give their best? What's in it for them? If you ask them to work to a higher standard, why would they? Other than, of course, the fear of losing their jobs. your people are going to be much more likely to offer their discretionary effort if they understand the higher purpose and their role in achieving it. Communicating that purpose relentlessly and helping people to find individual meaning is critical. The greatest opportunity to motivate comes when you can align your people to the core objectives of the organization, from top to bottom, with no loss of connection in between. So it starts at the top with the organization's purpose. It flows through to strategy, then into tactical and operational plans, and eventually, the purpose lands with extreme clarity at the frontline level. How do I fit into this picture? And what do I need to do today to contribute to the organization's success? I call this the school photo principle. People aren't capable of looking at the bigger picture until they can see where they fit in. I'm going to give you my 5 hot tips for motivating your people. Let me start with a few of the mechanics. The first, and probably the most fundamental thing, is that there's no substitute for hiring better quality people. Remember, in terms of return for effort, your best people return tenfold the outcomes when compared to your average person. So why spend all your energy motivating people who don't want to be motivated? Fill your team to the greatest extent possible with self-starters who want to achieve and deliver. It makes a monumental difference. It reduces the amount of time and energy you have to spend thinking about how to motivate someone. If it ain't broke, you don't need to fix it. The second mechanic of motivation, if you have the flexibility, align your pay scales to individual performance to the greatest extent you possibly can. Now, even though we know money isn't the ultimate motivator, you can give your best people a sense of appreciation and respect by ensuring they get paid more for going over and above. You want to align the rewards with the value that each individual creates. So make sure your best people feel as though their remuneration is fair. And here's a key mindset to adopt. A lot of your people are going to think they're worth more, but only you know if they actually are. Don't be afraid to differentiate. Don't be afraid to explain why when someone doesn't get the pay rise they want. And most of all, don't be afraid to let people go if they aren't happy with your assessment of their value, because you know. This is an important mindset shift. Remember, an empty house is way better than a bad tenant. The third tip is starting to get beyond the mechanics, and that is, paint the picture of the why as clearly as you can. This is the purpose stuff. It takes communication in both an upwards and a downwards direction to do this well. You've got to be really clear yourself on how the work of your team fits into the purpose and strategy of the company. And you have to be able to communicate it so that it's abundantly clear to your people. Remember, the holy grail of leadership here is to connect the higher purpose of the company to the work that people do at each level to fulfill that purpose. Now, this is not easy, which is why you need to be thinking about it constantly. The fourth tip is pretty straightforward. Stop doing dumb shit. Now, dumb shit comes in a variety of forms, but I'm talking specifically about breaking the principles of motivation that Dan Pink espouses: autonomy, mastery, and purpose. We've just spoken about purpose, and that takes active thought and engagement from every leader. But the other two tend to happen fairly naturally as long as you don't stuff it up by getting in your people's way. Let me just give you a quick example on autonomy. If you give someone a job to do or an outcome to deliver, then let them decide how it gets delivered. When you give someone a job, paint them a picture of the outcome you want: functional requirements, delivery date, quality level, and so forth. As long as they produce the outcome, the what, you should let that person have a large say in the how. Now, unless of course there are very precise and specific processes that have to be followed, which is sometimes the case. But if you tell someone what to do and how to do it, and then you hover over them, you're just micromanaging. When that happens, you're robbing that person of their autonomy, and you're spending time doing a job you shouldn't be doing. You're being paid to do your job, not theirs. My fifth and final tip is a little more sophisticated. When it comes to motivation, we often try to motivate someone so that they'll be moved to action. But one of life's immutable principles is that motivation follows action, not the other way around. Just think about your first weeks returning to the gym or lacing up your running shoes again after an injury layoff. Now, I guarantee that in those first few days and weeks, you're going to feel terrible. You have to haul your ass out of bed in the morning. Getting back out is the last thing you feel like doing. You're not motivated in any sense of the word. But you know that you can look forward to the outcomes that will eventually follow. And as the days and weeks go by, you start to see results. It starts to feel more natural. You feel the benefits of doing what you didn't feel like doing. That's when the motivation comes. And it's exactly the same with your people at work. You can try to motivate them with a short-term sugar hit, a pay rise, more flexible working conditions, a career development carrot. And look, there's nothing wrong with that at all. But if you want to motivate your people in a way that's more sustainable, you'll concentrate on helping them take the actions that are necessary before their motivation kicks in. This is why we have the Challenge, Coach, Confront framework. Now, the challenge phase is where you stretch people to do something that pushes them to the edge of their experience and capability. And let's face it, they may not like that at first. Just like you didn't like the alarm that woke you up to hit the gym either. But this is the door you have to walk through if you want your people to reach a state of self-sustaining motivation. All self-esteem comes from doing difficult things, period. If you truly believe this, you'll start to stretch your people more. Then the coaching phase kicks in, and this enables you to help them through that ugly period between taking action and finding motivation. So stay close to them. Help them to solve their problems. And make sure they don't lose sight of that light at the end of the tunnel. Be available when they need a shoulder to cry on. And most of all, don't let them off the hook until they get that sense of accomplishment that builds self-esteem and sustainable motivation. Let's face it, human motivation is an incredibly complex beast. And as the world of work continues to shift, there's many a challenge ahead for leaders. But the fundamentals don't tend to shift too much. Your challenge is to be confident enough to know what's best for someone in the longer term, even when they don't see it in the short term. And for that, you need to put respect before popularity. Your people, they're ultimately going to thank you for it.